I'm very interested in hearing your response to this. How do people react when you tell them that you work closely with dangerous spiders?
Ah!
That was probably overdramatic.
Hi, I'm Samantha, PhD student, here with my supervisor Glenn to answer some of your questions about doing a PhD.
Oh, we've got some questions, and I think I have the first one for you. So, why did you choose to do a PhD?
I chose to do a PhD because I really wanted to make a difference through science. And I wanted to be able to help people, I wanted to be able to help animals, and I wanted to be able to study the natural world. So getting to do a project for 4 years and learn all new techniques that would help me get those skills just seemed like the best way to do that.
Oh, you've certainly succeeded in all of those things.
So what's your favourite thing about being a PhD supervisor?
It's a really good question. My most favourite thing is just watching PhDs grow in confidence as they go through their PhD, and that means, and I tell students this at the very beginning, is by the end of their PhD, they should be the world expert in their topic, and they should know more than me, and that's generally true. By the end of their PhD, they've become confident, they're going out presenting their work at conferences, they're interacting with their peers in their field, they're looking at the next step in their career, they've learned how to plan their research project, they've learned how to write an impactful research paper, and just watching that progression is wonderful. But even more than that, watching what they achieve when they leave the lab is also an exciting part of being a PhD supervisor. So how did you find your PhD different to your undergraduate studies?
So first of all, my PhD and undergrad were completely different topics. So you don't have to be afraid to keep working in the same field. You can branch out and try new skills, new areas. I worked on wombats and bilbies, and then I moved into spiders for my PhD. So the first thing was the spiders are far more bitey than the wombats were. I think the biggest thing was in my undergraduate, it was much more structured. There was someone there who was giving me more of a plan, more step-by-step instructions. And then when you come into your PhD, it's really more about guiding your own project. You need to come up with the questions, you need to come up with a plan, a strategy, and you need to be resilient and think about what you can do when things go wrong, because they will go wrong. And I think that's really the big difference for me. In undergrad, there was someone who was telling me what to do and how to do it. In my PhD, it was really driven by me, but you still have someone there to support you. It's just much more independent. So next question for you, why are you passionate about research?
Well, for various reasons. I mean, there are, I think, two good reasons for wanting to pursue a PhD and do research, and that is basic intellectual curiosity, and that's a good reason. But for me, it's more about trying to do something that's useful. So most of the research in my lab is highly translational. What we're trying to do is develop environmentally friendly insecticides or human therapeutics for pervasive human disorders like chronic pain and stroke. And so I'm always focused on what the outcome will be, what the potential outcome would be, but at the same time satisfying that thirst for intellectual knowledge as we move through that process of developing drugs or developing new insecticides. So I have another question for you, and that is, why did you choose to do your PhD specifically here at the University of Queensland?
I chose to do my PhD at the University of Queensland because I think UQ is really one of the world leaders in life sciences, and certainly for venoms research. And I was really interested in not just doing something that would take place in the lab. I wanted my research to have real world impact in neglected tropical diseases, in wildlife biology. And I think UQ is really great at translating those discoveries from early initial lab-based work to commercializable real-world outcomes like we have with the cervical cancer vaccine, like we have with some of our solar power work. And that's what drove me to come here over at any other university.
This is going to be a difficult question for you because you've done so brilliantly in this area, and that is, what scholarship have you been awarded and how did you find out about it?
So I'm very lucky to have several scholarships to support my PhD, and I highly recommend anyone applying for PhDs to look for scholarships, because having scholarships has really enabled me to do so much more in my PhD, because I had that financial support, which meant that I could pursue my other interests in science communication, in community engagement and policy work. So I have a Westpac Future Leaders Scholarship from the Westpac Bicentennial Foundation, which is for leadership and research that will improve Australia's future. And I also have an Australian Government Research Scholarship, a scholarship from the Burroughs Wellcome Trust. And the way that I found out about those scholarships was really through talking to existing PhD students and finding out what support they had, and the graduate school and our research liaison officer, and that was how I was able to get my Australian government scholarship. And then the Westpac scholarship was through me looking out, doing some online Googling, reaching out into my network and finding out what other options were available, because I didn't want to just do a PhD. I wanted to be able to learn from people overseas. I wanted to be able to take my discoveries from the lab out into the real world. And the Westpac scholarship really enabled me to do that by giving me the opportunity to study in America, to study in Europe, to go to Antarctica, and even work in the Amazon, which really gave me the edge for my venomous animal research. What's the best advice that you would give to someone considering doing a PhD here at UQ?
Yeah, that's a really great question. The primary advice I would give is to choose a topic that you're passionate about, and that could be because you're intellectually passionate about it, or because you're after a particular outcome, such as developing a new drug, developing a new insecticide. But you must be passionate about it, because there are going to be points where it will be difficult, there will be long hours, and you need to have the passion and the enthusiasm to drive through those difficult moments. But the other thing that I would say is, and I get asked this by a lot of PhD students, and that is, does that determine my future career path? And the answer is no, it does not. So the PhD provides you with a basic set of skills in our case, in the biological sciences, which is a platform for then moving into any particular area you want to. So the PhD doesn't define what your future career will be in terms of your scientific discipline. It just provides a base of experience and skills to go onwards. So I have a question for you now. How do you think that your PhD will benefit you both professionally and personally?
I think my PhD has benefited me in a lot of ways that I didn't necessarily expect. Personally, I think it has improved my confidence. It has just given me a fantastic network of people doing the most incredible research in everything from spider venoms to neglected tropical diseases to drug discovery that I wouldn't have been able to get if I hadn't had this learning opportunity and the ability to explore my research and my area of passion. And professionally, I think it's given me so many skills, everything from time management. I had to manage my own projects, which were international collaborations, and had to learn how to communicate with people who came from very different areas of science, very different cultural areas. And those are the kind of skills that will be really valuable to you in whatever job you go into, whether that be some sort of industry position, policy, traditional academic research or clinical, because no matter what, you've gained a lot of skills in critical thinking and problem solving and in general resilience that I think I'll carry with me even after I finish. So Glenn, getting a bit personal now, what made you decide to be my supervisor?
Oh, that's an easy one. So I was very lucky in that Samantha had spent a year in my lab already doing an honours research project, which is a 1 year research project at which they write a thesis at the end describing their research. So I'd had a chance already to observe Samantha in the lab and interacting with my team for 10 months, and I knew she would be a brilliant PhD student because she was intellectually gifted. She was passionate about research, which is the most important thing. She was perseverant, which is also really critical for research. She pushed through the difficult moments, and she wrote very well, which is also important. And she was already a good public speaker at that stage, and I knew that we would turn her into a media superstar by the time she'd finished her PhD, and that's turned out to be the case.
Why is mentorship so important in our field, and why are you so passionate about it?
Yeah, look, I'm very passionate about mentorship, and I think that my most enduring legacy will actually be the PhD students I mentor, not the research science that I publish, because they are the next generation scientists. If without mentoring PhD students, there would be no future generation of research scientists. So I'm very passionate about that. It's very important that we transfer our skills. Our skills are often built up over many decades, and it's important to transfer that knowledge to our students so they can take that forward, set up their own labs, attract their own students.